Everyone, thank you so much for joining us. We are so delighted to have Russell Sbriglia here. Dr. Sbriglia will be giving us a presentation on Žižek and the Gothic today. So let me say a few words about him. But before I do that, I just want to set the parameters for our conversation, since this is also a class. So we'll spend an hour, all of us together. The Center for Literary Studies meets for an hour for all of its meetings. So we'll take this meeting from 5 to 6. And then we will end the meeting and we'll continue on the conversation with Russell and our students in the class, okay? So all of you from the Center for Literary Studies, welcome. It's delightful to see you. It's been a while. It's really good to have you here. And those of you in the class, hello, welcome. And Russell, most of all, we are so delighted to have you here. So let me say a few words about who you are, and then we'll get started with your presentation.
That's good, because I'm not sure who I am. Who I am. So I need this symbolic gesture of somebody else to introduce.
Yeah. Coordinates, so you can become symbolically inscribed.
Exactly.
All right. So Dr. Sbriglia is on the faculty at Seton Hall University, and he works on American literature of the 19th century. So he's a 19th centuryist, and you guys all are, for the moment, in the 19th century in this class. And of course, his interests are Lacanian, psychoanalytic, and he's interested in German idealism. He has edited some marvelous books, one of which we are reading parts of for this class, is one of his collections that you know and love, Everything You Always Wanted to Know About Literature But Were Afraid to Ask Žižek, from Duke, in 2017. And then he co-edited a book with Slavoj Žižek, you may have heard of him, Subject Lessons, Hegel, Lacan, and the Future of Materialism. He is now completing a book titled A Gainful Loss, Melville avec Lacan, which I can't wait to read. And this looks at the work of Melville's major phase, these amazing works such as Moby Dick and Pierre and Bartleby and Bonito Cereno. And this book also engages German idealist thought and Lacanian psychoanalysis. So Russ, I am going to switch now to a speaker view so that we can all look at you. Russ, take it away.
Thank you, Daniela. Thanks so much for having me and for all of you for coming. This is an honor to present this. I am going to try to share my screen because I have a presentation to share here. Okay, let's see. Can everybody see this?
Yes.
Okay. So this is going to be a talk on Žižek and the Gothic. And some of the things that I'm going to be touching upon are monstrosity, subjectivity, but especially this concept of the thing from inner space. And Professor Garofalo sent me, she sent me a copy of your syllabus, and as well as a couple of the videos that she recorded for your class. And so what I've really tried to do here is to come up with, present something that ties in with the material that you've been reading and discussing in class. So even though it's kind of framed like a talk, it really is kind of aimed directly at this class and the content that you've been covering. Okay, so Žižek and the Gothic, monstrosity, subjectivity, and the thing from inner space. Žižek first articulates the notion of the thing from inner space in an essay titled, appropriately enough, The Thing from Inner Space. The essay appears as a chapter in a collection titled Sexuation, edited by Renata Salekel. And you might notice that my collection on Žižek in literature, which you've read the introduction to, and which Professor Garofalo gave an excellent overview of in the video that you watched that she recorded. I was kind of jealous of it at points because I thought it might have been clearer than my introduction. So, but with this notion of the thing from inner space, Žižek is, of course, troping on a classic science fiction theme of the thing from outer space. Classic examples of which include 50s horror films like The Thing from Another World, which was famously remade by John Carpenter in the early 80s as simply The Thing. And also, it came from outer space from 1953, which was one of the earliest 3D movies, by the way. And the story for this film was actually written by Ray Bradbury, interestingly enough. So in films like these, the thing is an entirely alien other that intrudes upon our world from somewhere out there, that invades us from the outer reaches of the galaxy. What Žižek is interested in, however, and this is a result of his synthesis of German idealism, in particular the philosophy of Immanuel Kant and G.W.F. Hegel, and Lacanian psychoanalysis. What Žižek is interested in is how the thing, das Ding, the term Freud gave to it, is actually an outward manifestation or materialization of an internal alien, of a seemingly foreign being or agent that erupts on the scene, not from the outside, but from the inside. And as we'll come to see, and as you've already been discussing in this class, I know to some degree, for Žižek, this monstrous foreign agent is none other than the subject itself. This is subjectivity for Žižek. So in this essay of Žižek's, The Thing from Inner Space, he focuses on a handful of films that exemplify this, this phenomenon, that is The Thing from Inner Space. Among them, Andrei Tarkovsky's masterpieces, Solaris and Stalker. If you haven't seen those, I highly recommend them. James Cameron's film, The Abyss, also a great film. And perhaps most interestingly, he talks about this film by Peter Weir titled Picnic at Hanging Rock. And this example is kind of pretty interesting to me. Here are some, there's a kind of summary of the film right here on the poster. On St. Valentine's Day in 1900, a party of schoolgirls set out to a picnic at Hanging Rock, and some were never to return. And Hanging Rock in Australia, in Victoria, is kind of this strange, sublime geological formation. This is it. And it actually gets its name from these rocks that they hang in this sort of formation that defies gravity. And I just realized that in order to share this clip, I want to share my sound. Okay, so let's see. Hopefully you can hear this. But Žižek actually, I like this example of Hanging Rock because Žižek actually, in his film, The Pervert's Guide to Cinema, in talking about this scene from Vertigo, where I'm sure some of you have seen it, where the main characters, Scotty and Madeline, played by Jimmy Stewart and Kim Novak, go to this forest it's actually in California, and they encounter this giant tree. And Žižek actually has a take on this, and he refers to it as a thing from inner space, much like Hanging Rock. So let me make sure that you can all hear this.
It's the gigantic tree where in Vertigo, Madeleine and Scotty get together, almost embrace, where their erotic tension becomes unbearable. What is this tree? I think it's another in the series of Hitchcockian big things, like the Mount Rushmore statues, or take another example, like Moby Dick. This tree is not simply a natural object. It is, within our mental space, what in psychoanalysis is called the thing. It's effectively as if this tree, in its very extra large distortion, embodies something that comes out of our inner space. Libido, the excessive energy of our mind.
Okay, so you see there, before he goes off on libido, which is important, but I'm actually not going to be talking about that, but the tree, even though it's a natural phenomenon, it's something that is so sublime that the coordinates for trying to grasp it come from inner space, he says. So the tree is a thing from inner space. I actually like, here's another picture of Hanging Rock, and I actually like this image because I think it provides a nice segue into Žižek's discussion of a more properly literary example of a thing from inner space, even though in that clip we just watched, he mentioned Moby Dick, right? The white whale from Melville's great novel. But the discussion that I have in mind here, which is from his book, The Parallax View, is that of the famous stolen boat episode from William Wordsworth's masterpiece, The Prelude. And I like this image of Hanging Rock because it kind of reminds me of a scene that a lake poet like Wordsworth might have written about. But the stolen boat episode presents somewhat of a different scene. And here's the episode. It's very it's brief. I want us to just look at it. And this is from the 1850. There are like three different versions of it, but this is from the 1850 text. And this is the version that Žižek quotes in The Parallax View. So this is Wordsworth. "One summer evening, led by nature, I found a little boat tied to a willow tree within a rocky cove, its usual home. Straight I unloosed her chain and, stepping in, pushed from the shore. It was an act of stealth and troubled pleasure, nor without the voice of mountain echoes did my boat move on, leaving behind her still on either side small circles glittering idly in the moon until they melted all into one track of sparkling light. But now, like one who rose, proud of his skill, to reach a chosen point with an unswerving line, I fixed my view upon the summit of a craggy ridge, the horizon's utmost boundary. For above was nothing but the stars and the gray sky. She was an elfin pinnacle. Lustily I dipped my oars into the silent lake, and as I rose upon the stroke, my boat went heaving through the water like a swan. When, from behind that craggy steep, till then the horizon's bound, a huge peak, black and huge, as if with voluntary power instinct, upreared its head. I struck and struck again, and growing still in stature, the grim shape towered up between me and the stars, and still, for so it seemed, with purpose of its own and measured motion, like a living thing, strode after me. With trembling oars I turned, and through the silent water stole my way back to the covert of the willow tree. There, in her mooring place, I left my bark, and through the meadows homeward went, in grave and serious mood. But after I had seen that spectacle, for many days my brain worked with a dim and undetermined sense of unknown modes of being. O'er my thoughts there hung a darkness, call it solitude or blank desertion. No familiar shapes remained, no pleasant images of trees, of sea or sky, no colors of green fields, but huge and mighty forms that do not live like living men, moved slowly through the mind by day and were a trouble to my dreams." So that's the episode. Now, the first thing Žižek does is to gloss this episode, explaining that what actually happens in it is that the speaker, the young Wordsworth, is the victim of an optical illusion. And Žižek here quotes the following gloss by Alan Gardner in his book, The Poetry of William Wordsworth, A Critical Study. This is Gardner explaining what happens here. "When he rode away from the cave, the boy had fixed his gaze upon the top of a ridge, behind which there initially seemed to be nothing but the sky. As he rode further out onto the lake, however, a more distant peak behind the ridge came into view. The further he is from the shore, and his first instinct is to row faster," he says, "I struck and struck again, the more he can see of the mountain. It therefore seemed to be growing still in stature. There is then an extremely rational explanation for what the boy sees. His imagination, however, transforms the mountain into a living thing which strode after me," right? So that's the explanation, and Žižek quotes this. And it's at this point that Žižek begins explaining how this episode depicts the emergence of a thing from inner space. He says, "This is how a thing from inner space emerges. All the ingredients of a fantasy staging are here. The noumenal, that is, the realm of things in themselves, the ideal realm of things in themselves that lie beyond the phenomenal realm of the material experiential reality. The noumenal shines through in what is in fact just an optical illusion. That is to say, far from being a simple descendant of the Kantian thing in itself, Ding an sich, the German, the Freudian thing from inner space is its inherent opposite. What appears to be the excess of some transcendent force over normal external reality," right, the Kantian noumenal, "is the very place of the direct inscription of my subjectivity into this reality. In other words, what I get back in the guise of the horrifying, irrepresentable thing is the objectivization, the objectal correlate of my own gaze. As Wordsworth puts it, and this is not in the passage, but shortly after that I quoted, the thing is the sober coloring reality gets from the eye observing it. Okay, so I'll come back to this difference that Žižek is positing here between the Kantian thing in itself and the Freudian thing, das Ding, at the end of my remarks, because I think it's an important distinction. Now, another literary instance of the objectivization of the subject's own gaze, as Žižek here puts it, takes place in the book that you've been reading for class, Mary Shelley's Frankenstein. This cover image is, of course, a depiction of the following famous scene we're going to look at from the beginning of Volume 1, Chapter 4 in the 1818 text. All these books that I'm citing here have different texts. In other editions, I think it's Chapter 5, but it's Chapter 4 in the 1818 edition. So you'll remember this scene. It was on a dreary night of November that I beheld the accomplishment of my toils, right? This is Victor Frankenstein speaking. With an anxiety that almost amounted to agony, I collected the instruments of life around me that I might infuse a spark of being into the lifeless thing that lay at my feet. It was already 1 in the morning. The rain pattered dismally against the panes, and my candle was nearly burnt out when, by the glimmer of the half-extinguished light, I saw the dull yellow eye of the creature open. It breathed hard, and a convulsive motion agitated its limbs. How can I describe my emotions at this catastrophe, or how delineate the wretch whom with such infinite pains and care I had endeavored to form? And then these ellipses, we're going to actually come back and fill those in later. Unable to endure the aspect of the being I had created, I rushed out of the room. All right, so that's an important scene. In a frequently anthologized essay titled My Monster, Myself, literary critic Barbara Johnson cites a number of feminist readings of the novel that approach it autobiographically and that see in Victor Frankenstein's disgust at the sight of his creation a study of postpartum depression on behalf of Shelley, a rejection of maternal or a representation of maternal rejection of a newborn infant that reflects Mary Shelley's own mixed feelings about motherhood. And among these classic feminist readings of the novel are those by critics like Ellen Moores, Sandra Gilbert and Susan Gubar, and Mary Poovey. Approaching the novel more deconstructively, Barbara Johnson was a deconstructive critic, but she was also, interestingly enough, a Lacanian as well. She was this interesting mix of deconstruction and Lacanian psychoanalysis. But approaching the novel more deconstructively, Johnson argues that Frankenstein, the novel, can be read as the story of the experience of writing Frankenstein. What is at stake in the novel is the description of a primal scene of creation, she argues. According to this reading, then, like, to go by her title, My Monster, Myself, Johnson means to capture the relation between the novel and Mary Shelley, right? So myself would be Shelley, the monster is the novel itself, right? A more Žižekian reading, however, would argue that what the novel stages is a primal scene of subjectivity. According to this Žižekian reading, the phrase my monster, myself, would apply more to the monster and Victor Frankenstein than to the novel and to Shelley. And these are images from Kenneth Branagh's 1994 film adaptation, Mary Shelley's Frankenstein. And so that's Kenneth Branagh as Victor Frankenstein and Robert De Niro as the monster. This would be the Žižekian understanding of my monster, myself. For Frankenstein's monster is a sublime embodiment of what Lacan would call the extimate core of Victor's subjectivity. And I know that you've been introduced to the term extimate or extimite because you've read Mladen Dillard's essay on Lacan and the uncanny, I shall be with you on your wedding night, which of course is a line from the novel. It's like not just a message, but like a curse, a promise slash curse that the monster makes to Victor. You know, I was actually going to go into sort of a lengthy gloss of the term extimite here, but Professor Groffalo has already covered it, I thought, very well and very clearly in her video. But as Dillard succinctly defines it, the extimate, Lacan's term for the unheimlich, the uncanny, extimite points neither to the interior nor to the exterior, but is located there where the most intimate interiority coincides with the exterior and becomes threatening, provoking horror and anxiety. The extimate is simultaneously the intimate kernel and the foreign body. In a word, it is unheimlich. So something that is simultaneously homely and unhomely, familiar and foreign, intimate and alien. And this something is what Freud termed das Ding, the thing. In fact, Lacan specifically invented the term extimite to capture our relation to das Ding, characterizing it in Seminar 7, The Ethics of Psychoanalysis, as a relation of intimate exteriority, right? He says here, the intimate exteriority or extimacy that is the thing. And as he says of it later in the seminar, though he doesn't here use the term extimite, das Ding is something strange to me, although it is at the heart of me. And Lacan's favorite figure for representing the extimate is the Möbius strip, which is a paradoxical object because if you trace around it, like you can see trace lines here, it looks as though there are two sides, but it's actually a one-sided object that is bent. There's a torsion in it that makes it appear as though it's two-sided, but it really is only one side. And the most famous sort of actual visualization of this is ants crawling along it. If you were to follow an ant going along a Möbius strip, it would appear that it crosses over to two sides, but it actually doesn't. There's only one side. At no point are these ants on opposite sides, even though logically it would appear that they would be, right? So as Žižek would put it, the extimate relation between Victor and the monster is an embodiment, or the monster is an embodiment of that which is in Victor more than himself. That's how Žižek likes to refer to the extimate and subjectivity. We actually get a sense of this extimate relation between the two, Victor and the monster, albeit intentionally, in the pop cultural misnomer on display every Halloween, that the monster's name is actually Frankenstein, right? So I did a Google search a couple days ago, and the first thing that comes up when you type in Frankenstein is the monster. And you'll see a lot of things around Halloween where the monster is titled Frankenstein, right? That's wrong, but it gets something right, ironically, about the relation between the two. But a far more artistic rendering of this extimate relation between the two can be found in Danny Boyle's, here's the Boris Karloff, Frankenstein's monster, often mistaken for a creature named Frankenstein. But Danny Boyle's stage adaptation of the novel from 2011, put on by the National Royal Theater, starring Benedict Cumberbatch and Johnny Lee Miller, who actually, as you can see here, alternated in their roles as Victor and the monster, which is represented by this image as well. So they actually took turns. In some stagings, Cumberbatch was Victor and Miller was the monster, or he's titled Creature in the adaptation. And then in others, Miller is Frankenstein and Cumberbatch is the monster or creature. So that play gets something right about the extimate relation between the two. But back to Dillard's essay. Dillard recounts a number of Freud's examples of the unheimlich or the extimate, including the paradoxical realm between the living and the dead, the anxiety provoked by the double, which is the point where narcissism becomes unbearable. That's part of what Victor sees in the monster, is his narcissism reflected back. The evil eye and the dimension of the gaze, and cut off limbs. All of these things, apply in some regard to Frankenstein, to the novel and to the creature. And as Dillard continues, another quote, it is obvious that these different cases, these ones bullet pointed here, have a simple Lacanian common denominator, which is the eruption of the real into homely, commonly accepted reality, we can speak of the emergence of something that shatters well-known divisions and which cannot be situated within them. And so that's precisely what the monster does. He shatters these well-known divisions between the living and the dead, right? He's the living dead or the undead. Between the animate and the inanimate, he's comprised of various reanimated inanimate body parts. And most notably, the boundary between or distinction division between self and other, or subject and object. Okay, now, as one would hope, given the title of his essay, Dillard eventually himself comes to Frankenstein. And after providing a somewhat standard historicist framing of the novel, situating it within its proper Enlightenment and revolutionary contexts, and I know that Professor Garofalo focused on this in her video on Dillard's essay. After this, he transitions to a Lacanian reading of the novel, his gambit being that strong as some of these historicist readings of the novel may be, they nonetheless miss or overlook something crucial that the Lacanian approach allows us to see, and that is the extimate relation of the monster and Victor Frankenstein, which stands for an eruption of the real into the symbolic. Symbolic and real being two of the three psychic registers, or registers of psychic experience in Lacanian psychoanalysis, the third being the imaginary. So fortunately for us, Dillard frames this Lacanian reading around a discussion of the scene we looked at earlier, that of Victor's confrontation with the monster's gaze. So he says, this is Dillard still, the principal source of the uncanniness of the monster for Frankenstein, Victor, is precisely the gaze. And there's the monster's eye again. The point that Frankenstein cannot endure during the creation of the monster is the moment when the creature opens its eyes, when the thing renders the gaze. It is this opening that makes it the thing. When seeing those watery eyes, a quote from the novel, right, that seemed almost of the same color as the dun white sockets in which they were set, Frankenstein runs away in horror. The emergence of this impossible subject is the emergence of the gaze, the opening of a hole in reality, which is immediately also that which comes to fill it with an unbearable presence, with a being more than being, vacuum and plenitude all in one, the plenitude as a direct consequence of the emptiness. Okay, I want to actually focus on his use of the term impossible here, impossible subject. When he says the emergence of this impossible subject, this is another way of saying that the subject, as Žižek likes to put it, is a little piece of the real. That subjectivity belongs to the register of the real, that which is in excess of the symbolic, in excess of our everyday reality. Lacan liked to say that the real is the impossible. But that doesn't mean that the real doesn't happen, that the impossible doesn't happen. As we see in the case of Victor, the real does happen. And this is why the Gothic is such a privileged genre for Lacanian psychoanalysis. It presents us with these miserable pieces of the real, which are ultimately subjectivity itself. The point not to lose sight of, though, with respect to the monster's gaze, and this has to do with its extimate nature, is that it's not something separate or separable from Victor. Right? Things are not as simple as saying in this moment of the gaze, we have two separate beings, two discrete individuals who are locking eyes. Of course, on an empirical level, Victor and the monster are two separate beings, but on a psychic level, what happens when the monster opens his eye is that Victor is confronted with his own desire. He sees his own desire looking back at him, and that's the gaze. I mean, just as Žižek says of the young Wordsworth's experience in the stolen boat episode, would Victor, and this is from the earlier quote, an earlier quote from Žižek, would Victor gets back in the guise of the horrifying, irrepresentable thing is the objectivization or the objectal correlate of his own gaze. And as we've seen, Victor recoils from this in horror. And here I'd be remiss if I didn't mention a other line from Žižek's in the same film that I showed a clip from earlier, The Pervert's Guide to Cinema. Well, let me show you the clip. He's actually talking about the movie Vertigo, but the line, which if you haven't seen it, it's a little bit confusing, but the line is too good and he delivers it too well not to show it. So let me see here.
when Judy, refashioned as Madeleine, steps out of the door, it's like fantasy realized. And of course, we have a name, a perfect name for fantasy realized. It's called Nightmare.
Okay, I couldn't resist showing that. That line is great. Now, this is a very different scene from what happens in Frankenstein in certain regards, but it's the same dynamic. A fantasy is realized, and that fantasy, it turns into nightmare. All right. So that fantasy realized is nightmare is precisely what Shelley is asking us to wrestle with in the primal scene that we've been talking about. And so I'm going to go back and fill in those ellipses here. I'm going to skip the first paragraph here and go on to the second one. How can I describe my emotions at this catastrophe, or how delineate the wretch whom with such infinite pains and care I had endeavored to form? His limbs were in proportion, and I had selected his features as beautiful. Beautiful, great God! His yellow skin scarcely covered the work of muscles and arteries beneath. His hair was of a lustrous black and flowing, his teeth of a pearly whiteness. But these luxuriances only formed a more horrid contrast with his watery eyes that seemed almost of the same color as the dun white sockets in which they were set. That's a line that Dillard quotes. His shriveled complexion and straight black lips. The different accidents of life are not so changeable as the feelings of human nature. I had worked hard for nearly 2 years for the sole purpose of infusing life into an inanimate body. For this, I had deprived myself of rest and health. I had desired it, that's an important Lacanian desire, I had desired it with an ardor that far exceeded moderation. But now that I had finished, the beauty of the dream vanished, and breathless horror and disgust filled my heart. Unable to endure the aspect of the being I had created, this is a line we looked at earlier, I rushed out of the room. So, it's crucial not to mistake what Victor is saying here. He's not saying that he had a beautiful dream, but that because it was imperfectly realized, its results were disastrous and thus a horror. If you look closely at what he's saying, I mean, he does talk about, you know, his shriveled complexion and his black lips and the yellow eye. But what he's really saying is that beauty and horror share an extimate relation. His horror and disgust come from seeing his beautiful dream realized, from seeing fantasy actualized. And so to go back to Dillard and the gaze, is the gaze that occurs with such precision in all primal scenes of the novel. There are others like when Frankenstein, or I'm sorry, see now I'm doing it, when the monster first speaks, is an impossible gaze. And in this book of Jean-Jacques Le Sartre, Frankenstein, Myth and Philosophy, he points out that the gaze is situated at the presence of the gaze, as the presence of the gaze as the subject's own conception. It emerges together with the emergence of the subject in the moment of its conception, the gaze and the subject, as an or corp, like out of body, and an or sex, as though it's born of itself, without sex, outside of sex. That's why he says it is this object, the gaze, that would make the subject a causa sui, its own cause. Sort of self-generated if it could be integrated. The missing cause of subjectivity, the missing link of its emergence. So this scene, what I've been trying to point out here is that this scene is just as much about the birth of Victor's subjectivity in the form of the monster's gaze as it is about the birth of the monster himself. And note also that Dillard uses the term impossible here again, right? He says, an impossible gaze. He uses impossible with respect both to the subject and gaze because the two are in this extimate relation. In some regards, they're one and the same. Okay, so to approach a conclusion, to come full circle then and return to Žižek on the thing from inner space, in his book, The Ticklish Subject, Žižek, using Frankenstein's monster as his example, explains that, and this is a quote, the coincidence of utter alterity with absolute proximity, that's the extimate, that's the uncanny, is crucial for the thing. The thing is even more ourselves, our own inaccessible kernel, than the unconscious. It is an otherness which directly is ourselves, staging the phantasmatic core of our being. the communication with the thing thus fails, not because it is too alien, but because it brings us too close to what in ourselves must remain at a distance if we are to sustain the consistency of our symbolic universe. Something we have to disavow. That's another psychoanalytic term. In its very otherness, the thing generates spectral phenomena, as in the open boat scene, that obey our innermost idiosyncratic whims. If there is a puppet master who pulls the strings, it is ourselves, the thing that thinks in our heart. And that the thing that thinks, which is a Cartesian notion, res cogitans, that it's in our heart, that it's an extant thing that erupts on the scene from inner space, brings us back to where we started with Žižek's claim, which he made with regard to the stolen boat episode in Wordsworth, that the Freudian thing from inner space is not merely a descendant of the Kantian thing in itself. And here I want to look at one final passage of Žižek's, and this is from his book, For They Know Not What They Do. And let's see, reminding us that Kant placed the thing in itself utterly beyond human cognition and thus beyond human knowledge, right? For Kant, human finitude means that we cannot experience the infinite of the noumenal, of the thing in itself. So reminding us about this, Žižek points out that as if in direct response and rejoinder to Kant, the Gothic novel is filled with attempts to transgress this boundary between phenomenal and noumenal, material and ideal. So to quote Žižek one last time, he says, "The catastrophic consequences of the encroachment upon the forbidden, impossible domain of the thing are spelled out in the Gothic novel. It is by no means accidental that the Gothic novel, obsessed as it is with the motive of the thing in its different embodiments, the living dead and so on, is contemporary to Kant's transcendental turn." And this is what Dolar actually talks about in his essay on Lacan and the Uncanny, and Professor Garofalo stressed that point of the essay in her video, that this is in some regards a reaction to the Enlightenment and to the revolutionary era. We could, Žižek continues, we could even risk the hypothesis that the Gothic novel is kind of a critique avant la lettre, like before it actually happens, of the Kantian insistence on the insurmountable gap between phenomena and the transcendent thing in itself. What are the specters that appear in it, the Gothic novel, if not apparitions of the thing, if not points of a short circuit at which the transphenomenal thing invades the phenomenal domain and disturbs its causal order? And so I'll conclude with this, which is that the point that Žižek is trying to make here, one that's reflective not only of his Freudian Lacanian orientation, but also something I didn't talk about, his Hegelianism, in particular his subscription to Hegel's theory of the sublime over and above Kant's. I can talk about that more if people are interested. But the Lacanian Hegelian point that Žižek is trying to make here is not that the noumenal thing doesn't exist. Recall Lacan's earlier point that the impossible, the real is the impossible, but the impossible does happen, especially in the Gothic novel, in the form of these various monsters and specters, right? So here's the monster as a thing that thinks, right? De Niro playing the monster reading, or Boris Karloff's monster interacting and speaking with Victor. Žižek's point is not that the thing doesn't exist, but that it exists only as an eruption within the material, within the phenomenal itself, the phenomenal realm, as a rupture in the symbolic. And the name that psychoanalysis gives to this rupture in the symbolic, this monstrous inhuman excess that nonetheless bears an extant relation to the human, is the subject. Okay. Thank you very much.
Russell, that was great. Thank you. So we have some time for questions. That was wonderful. Actually, could I just start off, since you kind of invited this question? Can you tell us a little more about the difference between Kant's idea of the sublime and Hegel's idea of the sublime?
Sure. So, thank you. That's a great question. So for Kant, the sublime is indicative of this boundary between the phenomenal, the material realm that we experience, and the noumenal, the ideal. In things like the giant tree from Vertigo, or Hanging Rock, or Mont Blanc, right? That the mind, in its struggle to comprehend this grandiose part of nature, is kind of an indexical pointing to something beyond the material realm. And so for Kant, this is actually a sign of the human mind's triumph over nature, because even though it dwarfs us and makes us feel small, our ability to encounter the sublime and to survive it means that the mind is somehow over reality, right? And but still, we can't access the thing in itself. The sublime mountain, or the sublime thing, like Moby Dick, is just a sort of glimmer of what it is. And so for Kant, there's actually a positive noumenal beyond the boundary between material and noumenal. For Hegel, the noumenal actually is nothing. There is no positivization to the noumenal realm. There is no noumenal beyond us. It's actually the gap in the symbolic itself. I mean, Hegel doesn't use, symbolic is a Lacanian term. Hegel doesn't use the term symbolic, but the gap that opens up when things sort of break down in the symbolic, when logic breaks down and the real intrudes, that in and of itself is the noumenal, is the thing. And so it actually is part of a breakdown or a gap within our own reality, as opposed to this positive thing in itself that exists beyond the domain of the material. Does that make sense?
Perfect sense. And whenever I have a question about Kant or Hegel, I'm sending you an email, okay? You're going to be torment for the rest of time. All right, so questions from our guests at the center or our students. Questions, and maybe I'll open up the view so we can all see each other. There we go. Late, please.
Hi, yeah, thank you so much for the talk. Really exciting to have you here and give your presentation. So in relation to this idea of the sublime and Hegel and Kant and the object small a, I was wondering how you would relate that to infinite judgment in Hegel, because I got a talk with you, Žižek, and Dr. Tom McGowan, where you were kind of positing this idea that maybe infinite judgment is the key to understanding Hegel. Just particularly, I was almost wondering if this idea of infinite judgment is like man is non-mortal or Socrates is non-mortal, if we could talk about the real as non-being. But yeah, just what connections you see there.
Oh, that's really interesting. Yeah, thanks for that question. So just to a real brief gloss of that idea for people. So Hegel, it's also in his book, Science of Logic as well, but in a lot of the best examples come in his book, The Phenomenology of Spirit. And this concept of infinite judgment is when you have two things, it's when you posit an equivalence between two things that are absolutely incomparable, that can't be compared. And it's kind of like what happens, it's related in some, I'd have to think about this more, but I think it is related to the extant, in that the extant kind of is a form, just like the uncanny is a kind of form of the sublime in many respects. But some of the examples that Hegel gives are like Christ or God is man, or God is Christ. God is man is a better example, because, and he's talking about Christ crucified, right? How is it that God, the omnipotent, almighty, all-powerful ruler of the universe, is embodied in this man who's actually tried and executed as a criminal, right? But is supposed to be man. Another example he gives is that he says spirit, you know, the most ideal thing you can imagine is a bone. And he's talking about a skull, like in the pseudoscience of phrenology. And so I think that it is related to the sublime in a way, which is also related to the uncanny, because in some way, saying that Victor Frankenstein is his monster is a kind of infinite judgment in and of itself, I think, to equate those two, you're equating two things that are on the surface of it incommensurable, but actually they're estimately linked. I don't know if I answered your question, but yeah, Hegel. The reason why I think Hegel is interesting for thinking about this is because in his book, The Sublime Object of Ideology, it's the final chapter of Žižek's book, The Sublime Object of Ideology, which I think is titled not only as substance, but also subject, which is a line from Hegel. Žižek uses Hegel's idea of infinite judgment as to talk about the Hegelian sublime. So Žižek sees a connection there. And what I was trying to do in that talk that you, that point that I was making in that talk that you saw was to link the two and just kind of build off of that. But thanks for that question.
Other questions? And it doesn't have to all be about Hegel or Lacan. You can talk about Frankenstein or movies or any of the fun things that we saw in that presentation.
Hey.
You want to talk here?
Yeah.
Okay.
Hey, so sorry, Russ. So I heard in a podcast from Todd McGowan that aura, the Benjamin concept of aura, is taking a piece of art and sublimating it to the level of Das Ding. I almost presented over that yesterday. I was a little nervous. Can you try to explain that maybe?
Can you repeat the point really quickly?
Yeah, I'll start with that. So yeah. The idea is that when you take aura, the concept from Benjamin,
right,
that it's when you take a piece of art and you sublimate it, you make it sublime like Das Ding.
Ah, okay. So that's interesting, right? So you're referring to this wonderful essay by the German critic Walter Benjamin, the work of art in the age of mechanical reproduction, where he talks about the aura of the artwork. I hadn't thought about it before, but there is kind of a relation between that and sublimation. So since we're talking about the sublime here, and I mean, Frankenstein is often cited as examples of the sublime. I mean, the cover image that I have on this Norton edition is, you know, a very sublime photo, a sublime scene, painting by Caspar David Friedrich, who has a number of, there's the one where he's, oh, what's it called? Where he's stand, of the figure standing on the mountain. It's like it's almost a parody. It's used so much for figures of an image of the sublime. But sublimation is really interesting for Lacan. Like, so for Freud, actually, he would say that all artwork is a form of sublimation, which means that the artist is taking his or her libido, sort of sexual energy, and displacing it into the work of art. So Freud's theory of art is that it's almost all sublimation or sublimatory, because it's an outlet for libido, for sexual energy, sexual drive. But Lacan's is a little bit different, and you use that term elevate, which is important, because in Seminar 7, Lacan defines sublimation a little bit differently. He says that sublimation is the elevation of a common object to the position of the thing, or to Das Ding. And I think it was Lave mentioned it in his question, objet petit a, object small a. Lacanians actually have disagreements about this. Is objet petit a the same as Das Ding, or are the two sort of interchangeable? I think there actually is a difference between the two, but objet petit a, I mean, I would have no problem with referring to the monster and the gaze as either Das Ding or objet petit a, because objet petit a is the, well, it's the object cause of desire, but we mistake it for what we desire. But it's filling in various objets, like fill in the void that I was talking about in the phenomenal realm when the real enters. And so I think aura is actually an interesting concept to think about with regard to Lacan and to Žižek and the sublime, because the sublime body or the sublime object, because of the process of sublimation, elevating this thing, it does bestow it with a kind of aura that it doesn't have in itself. It's just a result of this psychic phenomenon, this sublimating it, this elevating it to the level of the thing. So that was another good question.
Russell, I have a question. I wanted to ask you more about this encounter with the sublime, facing the sublime or facing down the sublime. I mean, what survives? How do we survive? Do we survive that encounter, or what survives that encounter?
That's interesting. So in a way, I think I would steer it a bit. So I think that like a Žižekian or Lacanian position would say that, first of all, there's a difference between human being and subject. So subject is kind of this inhuman, I mentioned this in the talk, kind of this inhuman excess that comes from, that's one of my dogs, that comes from within the human. I'll tell him later. He's a star off screen. So for Kant, right? Like we do survive the encounter, with the sublime, although sometimes, you know, in the Gothic novel, you don't. But I think that what I think of the sublime is kind of, as in that scene from Frankenstein, the kind of birth of subjectivity. So I think that, so subjectivity is what survives. That's kind of what actually is born. And I think that that's the case with a lot of Gothic novels, or like sort of paragothic novels like Moby Dick, for instance. Like you could say that Captain Ahab, of course, by the time that he's, you know, he has his leg bitten off by Moby Dick, he's already middle-aged, but it's only then that he's sort of, when that leg is bitten off, that he's ushered into, like, not ushered into the symbolic, but that he becomes a subject in the sense of subjectivity being real. And so I think that sort of what survives in a way is that phenomenon that's outside of the human. Like it survives, but only outside of itself. And so the human being may or may not survive an encounter with the sublime, but there's something about the emergence of subjectivity that I think persists. Because the whole point of the sublime in Kant is that it sort of elevates us. It elevates human dignity in a way, by pointing, like steering us toward our freedom, which is why the sublime is ultimately, the critique of judgment. It's ultimately just as much about ethics as it is about aesthetics. But I don't know if I answered, I don't know if I successfully answered your question, but.
Callie.
Sure. So Russell, I was wondering if I could just ask a follow-up question on one of the latter points you just made in response to Chris, because as you were talking about almost like going through the veil, so to speak, and the emergence of subjectivity, I was thinking about a moment earlier in your presentation when you played that Žižek clip, and we had that funny line about fantasy realized is a nightmare.
Right.
Am I incorrect to kind of connect that scene with the question Chris asked and come to maybe this idea of emerging subjectivity? Are they comparable, or would you say they're two totally different scenarios?
So emerging subjectivity And what was the other scenario?
So I was thinking of more the scenario Chris laid out with confronting the sublime.
Right.
Would that process that eventually results in the emergence of subjectivity, possibly, would you say it's comparable to what Žižek was discussing with fantasy becoming nightmare?
Okay. Yeah, I think that's actually right. I think that I would say that is the case. And one way of sort of articulating that point would be, I don't know, I actually can't remember if Mladen Dolar talks about it in his piece, but have you guys encountered the formula for fantasy yet, with the barred subject, with the A, with object A? So if objet petit A is the sublime object, and the subject, right, it's, let me type it in the chat. I'm gonna have to do it as a dollar sign as opposed to what it actually looks like, but this would be the formula for fantasy, right? The barbs, the subject with a slash through it, and then the poisson or lozenge and the A, so that there is no subjectivity outside of being tied to the sublime object. So I think that for Lacan and Žižek, the two are certainly connected. And while you were talking, asking your question, Callie, it actually made me think of another example, which would be, and I think Dolar mentions it very briefly in that essay of his on Lacan and the uncanny, when he talks about that list that he gives of various forms of the uncanny that Freud mentions in his essay. And one is the realm between life and death. And for Lacan calls this like between the two deaths. And the most famous example of that probably is Antigone, when after she has already decided that she is going to die for the cause of burying her brother, and she's entombed alive. So she's already symbolically dead, but not physically dead yet. And then there's another, if you haven't read it yet, I really recommend it to everybody. It's short. I mentioned it in my introduction, and I know that Professor Garofalo mentioned it in her video on my introduction, but this Edgar Allan Poe tale, The Facts in the Case of Monsieur Valdemar, where this poor guy, Valdemar, he has a terminal illness, and he asks a mesmerist to put him under the spell, and he actually dies while under the spell, but because he's mesmerized, his body stays alive, and he's able to somehow speak beyond death, until once the mesmerist like snaps his fingers and breaks the hold, he just like melts into this puddle of detestable putridity. As Poe says, he turns into a puddle of the most loathsome, detestable putridity. It's one of my favorite lines ever. But I do think that, I mean, this is a roundabout way of answering. I do think that you can, that those two are connected there. They're sort of different forms of the same thing.
Perfect, thank you. You know, I'm gonna pause us because we've run out of time. And so I want to thank the members, the participants at the Center for Literary Studies for joining us. It's been great, it's lovely to see you all. And we're going to conclude our meeting now and allow our students to meet up with Russ for maybe 15 minutes or so and have a chat. So I thank you all, and I hope to see you on Friday at our close reading, our working group on close reading. I hope you can join us. I believe Professor Lemon will be presenting on Kafka on Friday. So please join us. That'll be a lot of fun. Thank you all. Good to see you.
Thanks for coming, everybody.
So Russ, this is our class. Some of us are in the room together and some of us are at home, so you can see us all here. My students have been reading your work, of course, and they've been seeing some of your YouTube videos, and I think they may have some questions for you on a variety of things. So I thought I'd just leave them with you. What do you think?
Sure.
okay, I'll just step out for like 10 minutes and come back and see what happens. And, you know, I'll come back and hopefully, you know, nothing outrageous goes on, but, you know.
The revolution will have, you'll miss the revolution.
Right. Other than that. Right. That's good. I'll be back soon.
Okay.
Oh, we'll use our own.
Well, I see. Mute my microphone so you can, oh, okay, that.
Hello, everybody. Do people have questions or comments while we're, you know, alone? Supposedly? I mean, Big Brother is always watching, but apparently we're alone. We'll pretend that we're alone here.
I appreciate that you tailored your talk specifically to what we had been already speaking of in class. That made it more relatable to recognize some of the things that you were talking about.
Well, you know, it's very difficult to talk about. I mean, because I teach this as well. Actually, you know, I was speaking with Professor Garofalo about this, but I really don't teach. I mean, I suppose I could, but I don't. I generally don't teach Lacan or Žižek in my undergraduate classes. Sometimes I teach him. So Seton Hall is it's a Catholic university, so that, which is it's very liberal as far as Catholic goes. But we have a class. It's in the core titled Christianity and Culture in Dialogue, which we actually, I teach it because half of the class is actually philosophical critiques of Christianity. It's sort of baked into it. But, and so sometimes I do like reread Marx in that class. And some, so I'll do some, you know, maybe a few pages of Žižek from his writings on Marx or the Communist Manifesto, but I generally don't try the Lacan stuff. And so this class seems really fantastic. But these concepts are, I think Professor Garofalo mentioned this in one of her, one of the videos that she sent me, that she's been, you know, doing this for years, you know, as have I, and we're still confused and puzzled by a lot of things. And so it's not something that you grasp even over the course, you know, grasp fully over the, if you can ever grasp it fully, over the course of many years. And she also made a point in one of the videos that even Žižek, if you read, you know, this frustrates some people, but you'll read one of his books and he'll say, this is objet petiar, this is subject. And then you read a book like from 10 years later, and he seems to say either the opposite or something else. And it's not that he's sloppy or contradicting himself, but because his views of these things are evolving. And, you know, if you actually go through and read Lacan's seminars, his concept of objet petit a, just to take one example, that changes drastically from the mid to late 1950s through the late 70s and some of his later seminars. And so also I just love Frankenstein and the Gothic. So yeah, I wanted to be mindful of that when presenting, because I wanted it to be kind of a talk, but I also wanted it to be accessible. And the problem with Lacan often is that if you come to it cold, he doesn't seem very accessible. So so thanks for that. I'm glad I purposely tried to make it accessible. So I hope it was. Yeah, Leif.
Yeah, so I have a few questions, but I'll try to keep it short. I was kind of wanting to talk about Death Drive a little bit, because the act also seems pretty important to the sublime, and also the subject is freedom. So one thing interesting in the whole infinite judgment discussion is that there's like the negative infinite judgment and the positive infinite judgment, where the negative has that incommensurability of like the rose is an elephant. Right. And then there is the positive, which is the rose is a rose, which is this tautology, but for Hegel has this minimal difference. And I really appreciate it. You helped me understand more how to kind of connect up this idea of infinite judgment to the relation.
Well, so just quickly, you saw when I mentioned that with the thing with Slavoj and Todd McGowan, but I have a talk on Hegel and infinite judgment and vertigo. I don't know if you see, I can send that. I'll, if you send me an email And I'll send you a link to that too, because I talk about it. Like it's like a 15-minute talk. Mm. I can send it to you, but
yeah
sorry. Please. I just wanted to, before I forgot, I wanted to mention that.
Yeah, no, thank you. So I'm just trying to think about, like, at the moment of the sublime, when you encounter the thing, the object, and it breaks you down, breaks down your symbolic identity. I see this related to ACT and to Death Drive as a moment where you can leave your symbolic identity behind and, you know, do a truly ethical act, do a totally free but necessary act. So I was wondering, maybe if you could just expand on a relation you see there. And Yeah,
it's a great question. I'm just beginning to work this out for a chapter in this Melville book that Professor Groffalo was kind enough to mention. So Melville, the novel that Melville wrote after Moby Dick, this book Pierre, which is an insane, it's an insane novel. It's crazy. It pretty much ruined his career. It has everything. It has incest. It has all kinds of crazy stuff in it that critics, incest is actually there in a lot of Gothic literature from the outset, but he was like very, it's a crazy, but it's all about committing an ethical act. And I think that the act and freedom is related to the sublime because, right, so for Kant, the idea, so Kant has, when people say finitude with Kant, that Kant is a philosopher of finitude, they're talking specifically about this line that he draws between phenomenal material and the ideal, right? So if we were infinite, we would be able to access it. But for Kant, it's a good thing that it's positive morally, because if we had access to the thing in itself, then we would know what God wants of us. We would know what the good is, and there would be no freedom. There'd be no ethical act. So the gap there between phenomenal and noumenal is the very, that gap enables our moral freedom. What's interesting, and what Žižek really calls attention to, and I'll try to think of I can't think of specific ones, instances off the top of my head, but I know he talks about it in a number of his books, is that the ethical or moral act is kind of sublime. I mean, Antigone makes an ethical act. That would be a good literary example of the ethical act. And the act itself, like in asserting the ethical, like breaks you, it actually breaks you down. It kills you in a way. So like in the Melville novel, Pierre, the titular character Pierre, is faced with the dilemma is that he has a young woman comes to him claiming to be his illegitimate half-sister, that his father has passed away. This woman comes to him. Pierre is rich. He's an aristocrat. And this poor like seamstress comes to him and claims that she is the child of an affair that his father had with this poor French girl, right? And the act that Pierre has to make is, do I recognize this woman, Isabel, as my family when everyone around him, wants him not to? And he ultimately does, but it ends up, the trajectory after he does that is a straight trajectory downward. It's a descent. So the act in and of itself is kind of sublime, but the interesting point that Žižek teases out in Kant is that oftentimes the act, a free act seems the opposite of freedom. It seems like fate, right? So Pierre feels, in the example of Pierre, or Antigone would work just as well. They feel the weight of their world on their shoulders. They feel like they're not free to act. Like they can't do anything but what they conceive to be the good. And so it seems like fate, but it is an actual free act. So I think Žižek might have a chapter or a section of a chapter titled Freedom Hurts. And it's a reference to Kant. Kantian freedom hurts. It is sort of monstrous and sublime in a way. Another thing that Žižek says though is that oftentimes we don't realize that we've committed an act until afterwards. Like retroactively, we realize that we've committed an act and can build it up It's the same thing with the concept of the event. Like, sometimes you don't know that an event has happened until afterwards, and you retroactively say, oh, that was an epochal event. That was a big shift or something big that happened.
Awesome. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Anyway, I think we have a couple more minutes. Yeah, Samuel?
We discovered feedback.
That's weird because it's muted in the that mic is muted. Let's see. Maybe he has to mute the room mic. Okay, this will work.
Okay, this will work. So yeah. Sartre talks about like being for itself as sort of this like kind of negative subjectivity. How much different or similar is this sort of negative subjectivity to that idea?
You know, that's another great question, because I don't think that I can give, I would kind of be sort of just like, you know, making it up as I go along if I try to give a definitive answer to that. But I've been thinking more and more about the existentialists and Lacan, because in some regards, Lacan was hostile to Sartre, but because I think Sartre and the existentialists, they don't have a fully formed theory of the unconscious. They kind of disavow the unconscious, but I do think that there's a relation there. I don't know if it's the same thing, but there's an existential element to psychoanalysis that hasn't been, people have talked about it, but it hasn't been fully fleshed out. So like what I would say is, it's a great question. I have to think about it more, because I've been meaning myself to think about this connection between Sartre and Lacan, but I don't really have a good, that might be unsatisfactory, but I think it's a great question.
It's a great answer. Thank you so much.
So I am new to all of this, very, very new. So take this with a grain of salt. But when Žižek like builds up to that claim that the thing from inner space is the subject, I don't feel like it's hitting right for me, because I'm just kind of like, okay, what does that mean? Like, what is that doing to our understanding of subjectivity? I'm just kind of like, that sounds like a cool idea, but I don't really understand what that would mean, like practically speaking.
Yeah, well, it's a good question, because so I've been working a little bit on this. I mean, I don't know that I have a good answer to what it means, other than oftentimes these sort of acts that we make, we do it for unconscious motives, and then later we sort of realize why we've done it. But I can see your skepticism here, because there's a long tradition in philosophy, really sort of beginning with Descartes, that subject equals the I or the ego, right? And Lacan, who considered himself sort of in the Cartesian tradition, has this great line where, well, first of all, he says the subject for Lacan is the subject of the unconscious. So I mentioned that, I quoted from that Žižek book, For They Know Not What They Do. That could almost be a gloss for psychoanalysis in a way. Like, I mean, think about the figure of Oedipus. Like, he knew not what he did. he killed his father and slept with his mother, married his mother, but he knew that he killed somebody and married somebody, but he didn't know what that meant when he was doing it. And so the subject, what Lacan, and I think Žižek even does a better job of this, is trying to like sever the idea of subject from the I, or from the human being. So like the I, who consciously rationally makes decisions, that's oftentimes referred to, you know, the sub, like someone's subject position or a subject. But like the Lacanian understanding is that the subject is this sort of spectral phenomenon. There are different modes of and times of the subject, but the subject is almost always out of joint with the actual human being or person who's experiencing subjectivity. So I don't know if that, I mean, your question about like the sort of practical implication of, I think it is a good one. And I think it's good to be skeptical of it. So I understand where you're coming from. But I think like Žižek's answer would be the subject, it can only exist, subjectivity only exists outside of itself. And so we have to divorce it from this notion of like interiority or consciousness or conscious aim. Like subjectivity is, it is a thing from inner space, but it's also, it's out there. It's extant. I don't know if that's a satisfactory answer, but that's
it helps a lot. Like I have a feeling I'm going to get there someday. I'm just like, I have to work at it. So yeah, that actually does help me a lot to think of the subject.
Hey, good. I'm glad. Okay, good. I'm glad.
So just one last question, because it's getting late and Russ is actually an hour ahead of us. So one last question, and maybe a question, like I was suggesting, maybe something more gothic focused. All the questions have been gothic in a sense, but maybe more literary or filmic. From someone who hasn't spoken about that. Those are my conditions for the last question of the evening. Anyone?
No.
Yes, Brenna, go ahead. Oh.
Okay, in this class we read Dracula and Frankenstein and Wuthering Heights and The Turn of the Screw. If you had to write a final paper, what are some things that you would isolate from those works that you would maybe think would be good and juicy to write a paper on?
Good.
Boy. Let's see. Well, out of those, I know The Turn of the Screw the best, just being an, I mean, I've read all of them, but I know The Turn of the Screw the best because being an Americanist. Although Henry James is kind of extant with regard to British and American, like both traditions claim him. I think that you could actually apply the concept, you know, I think you're reading Shoshana Feldman on, yes, on The Turn of the Screw, but I haven't done a lot of work on Henry James. I teach The Turn of the Screw a lot, but I don't know if there's been any work done on Extimite or The Extimate and that novel or novella, because it's interesting. It's kind of strange because like in a novel like Wuthering Heights or Jane Eyre, like there's the huge gothic element, but things get solved like there's an 11th hour revelation, like a Scooby-Doo episode, like all the supernatural phenomena that you've been experiencing at the end, it's like, oh, well, there's perfectly rational explanations for this. Just like in that Gardner gloss of that stolen boat episode. Oh, well, we can explain this perfectly rationally. It's that his mind was playing a trick on him. You know, it wasn't really a monster. The mountaintop that he saw wasn't really a monster that was chasing him or coming after him, right? And in The Turn of the Screw, I mean, not to give it away for those, but it's much less unclear. And that you'll see there are apparitions that it's unclear if they're actually there or if it's a sort of, and I mean hysterical in like the sort of psychoanalytic sense, a sort of hysterical hallucination on the point, you know, in the mind of the character. So I guess like I would say that concept is of extimacy is applicable to that novel. But, you know, there's a lot that's applicable to Dracula as well. Like Žižek has talked about Dracula, I think maybe even just as much, if not more than he has talked about Frankenstein. So, but that'd be one sort of, you know, hint or one suggestion that I could put out there.
That's great. Thank you, Russ. We've exhausted our time and I'm sure we've exhausted you, but you've made us very happy. So I thank you very much.
Thanks everybody. This was a lot of fun. I was very happy to do it.
Great. Thank you so much for joining us tonight.
Thanks
again. Take care, Russ.
Okay.
Bye.
Bye, everybody. Thanks.